We will continue. You all have been coming to me with wonderful questions as you can continue. I did send a text message to my supervisor asking some of the questions that you were all asking me. And if I don't answer your question, I will take down your name and number, and I will call you back. Because I did leave my phone after I texted my boss, I left it in the room. So I'll check my bag again, though, during break to see if she answers. But now we're going on to the thrift savings plan. Do we have any questions before we get started? Because I know a lot of people were asking me about survivor benefits during the break and different things like that, life insurance. Because that's what we're here for, to answer any of the questions that you may have that are just kind of going around. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. You have a mic close by, raise it up. Okay, somebody has one.
Looking at lunchtime, I wanted to get some clarity regarding the annuity and if you or your retirement date is not the last day of the month or the first 3 days of the month. I mean, you still receive retirement pay for that period. You just don't get it immediately, right?
It doesn't start accruing until the first of the month. So there's a gap where you're not going to be getting anything from your pay because you're not working, and you're not getting anything accruing towards your retirement. You're kind of in limbo right there.
So that time, say you would retire on the 15th of the mm-hmm. month, that time you aren't receiving any credit for that time.
Right.
Okay, so that clarifies what we were worried about. Thanks.
Good question. Okay. So we'll move on to thrift savings. And at the end, I can slide in my card so I could show you guys EBIS. If you want to look through EBIS or if you want to find the forms online, I can show you exactly where to go to make it a lot easier for you because it looks like we're going to have some time. I know I talk fast, but I didn't know I was talking that fast where we're flying through this. So I do apologize. If I'm talking too fast, just let me know, and I will most definitely slow down. So, yeah. Somebody said one question? Okay. So, for your thrift savings plan, these are the main numbers to call, even though we do assist. And I'm going to tell you about some of the things we do at our office to assist you with your thrift savings plan. But they are their own, I don't want to say island, but they keep their information locked up tighter than Fort Knox. So when I call and you say, Myesha, I need this about my TSP. If I call them, they were like, no, we're not going to tell you. And I have to do that call for my own. And I'm like, no, it's me. I want to ask about myself, you know, and before they hang up on me, because they do not play when it comes to people's money. They do not answer just general questions about, so I can't inquire about your information. So call them, get whatever you need, and they will assist you. Next. We're ready. Your thrift savings provides the opportunity to increase your retirement income with a choice of tax treatments for contributions. So you can contribute to your TSP in the traditional way, which is the pre-taxed, and the tax-deferred investment earnings. And you can do the Roth, which is after-tax. Now, the Roth is new. We've had it for a little bit now, but it's still fairly new. And so you can determine which one you want to contribute to. You contribute to both of them. You can talk to your financial advisor, if you have one, about which one is the best for your situation. Because just because your neighbor says, I contribute to the traditional, it might be to your best benefit to contribute to the Roth. You must be in a position subject to retirement deductions to contribute. So if you're in a FICA position, you cannot contribute to thrift savings. If you come back as a re-employed annuitant, you're going to have some issues because you're only contributing to FICA, so you can't contribute to your thrift savings. TSP offers two approaches of investment. They have the life cycle fund, which is the L fund, and they also have the individual funds. And so we're going to break down the difference between all the different types of funds that they have out there. The G fund. Now, if you're scary like me, you've probably had your money in G fund forever. So this is where most of my money sat for the first 7 years of my federal employment because I was too afraid to move anything around. I really didn't want to touch anything. I didn't feel educated enough to move things around. Well, that would have been a good thing if I hadn't touched it. I think it was 2008 when everybody lost so much money, including myself. But the benefit of being in the G fund is that it's a low risk, and we'll see that in a little bit. As you begin to move your money around, you can see the benefits of it. And there's a whole chart that's going to show you the benefits of, you know, the different funds. So there's the G fund is the lowest risk, and you can see over the 10-year annual rate is a 3.61%. So that's low risk. The fixed income, the F fund, it's a government, corporate, and mortgage-backed bonds. And you can see the different ones, but it's a low to moderate risk, and the 10-year annual return is 5.25. So the greater the risk, sometimes, the greater the return. You have the common stock, so that's the C fund. And that's stocks of large and medium-sized U.S. companies. It's a moderate risk, and you can see the return over 10 years has been 7.12%. And then the S fund is the small capitalizations, and so the stocks of small and medium-sized U.S. companies, they're earning potentially higher rates, higher investment returns over the long term than in the C fund. It's a moderate to high risk, more than the C fund. So it's a little bit more risky than the C, just a little bit. And you can see over a 10-year annual return is 10.79%. The international stock, which is the I fund, that's international stocks of 21 developed countries. And this is the high-risk one. So it says moderate to high, and the 10-year annual return is 8.39%. Now, the life cycle fund, this is probably the newest one to the TSP, even though it's been out there for a minute now. But this is the newest thing, which is each L fund is invested in the individual TSP funds. So they're going to move your money around for you depending on which life cycle you put it in. They're going to help you invest your money. So here's just a chart. Now you don't, just because you don't retire until 2030 in that life cycle, you don't have to, like, I don't have to put my money in L2030 because that's my retirement eligibility. I can put it in all of them, and that's what I did. I just put a little bit in everything. I'm still playing it safe, I know. But I put a little bit in everything, so it doesn't matter. You can use whatever one you want, but what they're trying to do is show you if you're kind of retiring between 2015 and 2024, this is how they're going to grow your money moderate to moderate. So as the L income one was the first one, that's now moving out of the way because 2015 is up on us. So 2015 is really going to be the lowest. They're going to invest low. You're going to have low growth, and they're going to invest low on your money because they don't want to take risk with your money right before you retire. That's not the time to be taking risk. The time to be taking risk is when you have a lot more time to invest into TSP. So, I mean, if you play it safe. But you can put it into any one of these. You don't just have to put it in the, within the years that you are retiring. You have a question? Okay. Okay. Now, here is the life cycle allocation charts. And you can see on the chart, on the L income chart, how they are investing your money. They put a lot of the money in the G fund because it's the safest one. And like I said, it's not the time to start playing with your money when you're about to retire. So they put a lot of it, and then they still give some out into the other funds, but they're not really going to dump a lot into the G fund when you're about to retire. And as you go down, you can see that they're starting to diversify it just a little bit more to where they're taking risk. And the people that don't retire until L2050, they're really, you know, they're flexible with their money. And so what percentage? So if they put $100 in, 3.83% is going to the G fund. And you can see 43% of their $100 would be going to the C fund. So they're just taking a little bit more risk with the money because you have time on your side if you're not retiring until 2050. So that's kind of how they are breaking down the life cycle funds. Okay. When you retire, if you have less than $200 in your TSP, they're just going to write you a check and send it to you. He said that's all that's left. Okay, and then you have the option of leaving your money in TSP. You can do several different withdrawal options. You can do an age-based withdrawal, the full withdrawal. The full withdrawal is a single withdrawal where you just say, you know what, I have $10,000, I'm taking my money and I'm going. You can do a monthly payment. So if you have $10,000, you can say, I want $1,000 every month until it's gone. Or you can do a lifetime annuity. And that means I know I have this amount in the bank, in my TSP, and I want you to give it to me over the course of, for the rest of my life. So even if they give you they have a calculator for a life expectancy. And so the TSP does all this themselves. And they'll say, okay, this is how long we expect you to live. And they'll pay you out however much is in your account over the period of time. Now, if they didn't calculate it right and you outlive it, they'll still have to pay it to you. So that's the benefit of that. Mm-hmm.
The full withdrawal, but when you do monthly payments, does that mean, okay, you're going to get a monthly payment, but the money that's still in that hasn't paid you, is that still in the system possibly gathering?
Yes. It's still, the money that you leave, it's still accruing.
Still drawing whatever interest or not really interest, but if you're in, it's still in the G fund, fund or whatever.
The growth, should
the
we
growth,
say.
The growth, right. Yeah. So it does.
It still grows.
So I wonder how they can actually figure out the life annuity. I mean,
that's
their problem.
Well, it's not their. I bet if you go on their TSP website, they do have some programs out there. Now, I don't know if they have the life expectancy calculator because I'm not for sure how they work that. That's more of an internal TSP. But feel free to call them and ask them those questions, because they most definitely will give you a straightforward answer and say, hey, you know, we expect life expectancy for this group is for till this, you know. Are you a baby boomer? We expect you to live this long. If you're a millennial baby, we expect you to live this long. So they have a chart, and they didn't give us access to it.
So if you select monthly payment, say you have $10,000. So once you get the first check, just say you have whatever, $9,000 now. If you lose money towards that $9,000, your next check might be $8,000.
You might want to contact TSP on that.
Okay.
Because I'm not for sure how they work that out to where they can give you the even payments. So just go ahead and give them a call and say, hey, for example, if I had $10,000 and I wanted $1,000 every month, how does that interest work and how do the growth and losses work according to what fund I have it in? And they will be able to answer that one for you. Okay. Mm-hmm. They have the mixed withdrawal. Yeah, I'm sorry. Yes.
Say I retire at 57.
Mm-hmm.
I want to pull all of my TSP funds out mm-hmm. and roll it over to whatever I control through my bank or whatever. What's the penalty for single payment, pull it all out, and roll it over to, like, say, a CD or a 401k through our banking system?
For rolling over, I think there's a slide on that. Hold on. Don't quote me on this, because you're going to have to call TSP, but when you roll over, there should not be a penalty for rolling it over. When you pull it out, that's the tax. When you just say, cut me a check, and if you were to cut that check and put it into an IRA, wherever you wanted to put it into, you don't want to do it that way. You want it to roll over. So you would have, I think that form is, it's the TSP. Don't give me the line, because I don't know TSP forms like that. I think the only one I do know is TSP 71, where you can get your money. So, yes, sir. Not if you retire. Retirement is different.
Retire.
If you are eligible to retire under optional retirement, you can apply. Because there's something that's sent. We send a flag. It's sent electronically now that we send to TSP to let them know that you are retired.
Okay, so if I retire at 55,
yes. Well, hold on. Let me get that. Let me write that down. Because 55 is 50.
Sure.
It's 59 and a half.
Right. 59 and a half.
Right. 59 and a half. 55 is too young, because the chart says. I'm looking on page 55 with 30 years under optional.
Higher. I don't know if this is on, but if you retire, regardless of your age, you can withdraw from your TSP without penalty.
Let me look that up, okay? Let me look that up real quick, because
that'd be great. I wasn't under that impression.
I believe the age is 59 and a half.
59 and a half is with no penalty.
With no penalty, right?
Right. 59 and a half is without no penalty. But I know that retirement is a different ball game, because a lot of people want to just leave the federal government and take their money, and I know there's a penalty for that. So let me check on the, if you're retired at 55 with 30 years of service. I want to check on that one for you, okay? Let me put a star on this slide. And what was your name? Okay. TSP, let me go back one time.
Okay.
On here, it says, now you can do a mixed withdrawal. So if you want to do a payment, let's say that you have $10,000 in there, you can take $5,000 out and then leave the rest in there and get either a monthly annuity on that. So you can have different payments. So you can mix any of those, different withdrawal options. So that's what it says, mixed withdrawal. You must begin receiving your TSP by April 1st of the year following the year you are 70 and a half. If you don't, you will be penalized. And you will have to probably call TSP back and get your money back if you can. So make sure if you're retired, if you're still working and you're 70, that doesn't apply to you. Once you retire, you need to start withdrawing that. Okay, so TSP makeup contributions. You are eligible to make up missed TSP contributions if you meet all the following conditions. You were placed in leave without pay U.S. or separated from federal civilian service to perform military service. You were released from military service on or after August 2nd of 1990. You were reemployed in or restored to a position covered by CSRS or FERS. Requests must be submitted within 60 days after you return to duty. So those are mostly the military people. When they go on, they have to leave the federal government to go fulfill their military obligations. They miss giving to their TSP. And if they do so on the military side, they can they'll apply for agency matchings. That's probably FERS people. But if you miss giving to them, you can do what we call as the makeup contributions, okay? If you contribute to TSP during your period of military service, the amount you can make up will be reduced by the amount you contribute to your military TSP account. And that's just not letting you go over the TSP limit. They're not going to let you contribute more than the TSP limit. Your makeup contributions will not count against your current year's IRS limit. TSP makeup contributions, you will need to submit an employee's request for TSP makeup contributions, which is on our website, your DD-214 or military orders, all military leave and earning statements to verify the TSP contributions while on active duty, provide your request form and documents to your local HR office. Okay, so if you go and do military service and you want to make up the TSP contributions that you missed, you can do so. That's just what that's letting you know. Go back one, please. Okay, TSP catch-up. That's open to participants age 50 and older. You're not eligible for agency automatic 1% matching contributions. The limit is $6,000 for 2015. You must be contributing the IRS yearly maximum of $18,000 for 2015. And you must make a new election every year. So there's times people want to say, you know what, I need a little bit more in my TSP. I haven't saved enough, or I really want to live comfortably into retirement. So they said, I can max out and give $18,000. On top of the $18,000, you can contribute an additional $6,000. What you do, you don't have to contribute $18,000 already in order to do the catch-up. You have to be planning to contribute the $18,000. So if you're piece it off throughout the year, every paycheck, then you can make it happen. And you can also, you can do that at the beginning of the year. So you say, you know what, I'm planning on contributing $18,000, plus I want to do the extra $6,000. You make those contributions in December for your catch-up. So this way, you're able to maximize it throughout the year. Now, there's some people who are going to retire, I heard someone say, in June. You can play with your formula so that you contribute everything before you retire. You can contribute the whole $18,000 and the $6,000 before you retire in June. And because you don't get agency matchings, it doesn't really matter how soon. Now, for the FERS employees, it does matter. Because if you contribute the $18,000 by June, you're going to miss out on all your agency matching. So for CSRS, you don't have that penalty. Okay, so any questions about TSP or catch-up or matchings or anything like that? Yes, ma'am.
Beneficiary form that you have listed on page 55 for the TSP. Mm-hmm. How does the beneficiary work on the TSP? Say you have $100,000 in there that you do not start drawing until you're 70 and a half, till you have to, and 1 month after you start drawing, you're gone. Does your beneficiary get the balance in one lump sum, or do they get monthly amounts?
It depends, because TSP also has something. Now, you would have to contact them to see if they have the spousal benefit. I think that's what you're thinking of. I don't know about that, if TSP has that or not. I do know that if you do that beneficiary form, they're going to pay a lump sum. It's just a lump sum with the beneficiary form. Okay.
Can you increase your TSP at any time through the year, or is there a special time of year that you can only do that?
No, you can increase TSP any time. So if you're contributing $100 and you say, you know what, I can contribute $200 now, and that's once all four kids are out of college. But I can contribute $200. Big money, right? Mm-hmm. But once I'm able to, let's say it's the 2nd of January, I can go ahead and change that. And then if, let's say, you know what, something else comes up, I can always decrease. So TSP, you can increase and decrease. There's no period anymore. I think you're thinking back when it used to, you can only do it during certain times. Yeah, you don't have to do that anymore. Good question. Yes, ma'am.
I just want to make sure I understand. Your office is the office that sends in each individual separation code to TSP, right?
We send in the retirement one. So when you retire, we tell them that you're retired.
Okay.
Is that what you meant? Or
well, they said they receive a separation code.
Right.
And then they send the individual something in the mail saying they receive it, so we know to go ahead and submit a form, a TSP form, to start our
retirement. Yes,
right, because they won't do it without someone sending them in a separation code, they told me.
Correct. So you can't just call TSP and say,
right,
I'm retiring.
Right.
They're going to say, we don't have anything from your agency. You, the system is electronically set up to, bam, send something to TSP to let them know that you have retired. It doesn't send it until after that SF-50 prints out. The SF-50 doesn't print out until the day after you retire. Yeah. And then when you get it in the mail from us, it's usually about 2 weeks after you retire, you'll get your SF-50. But a lot of people, I had one gentleman, he needed his money right away. And I said, I can't help you, because the SF-50 hasn't printed. So he was able to go to his local HR and say, can you go under X employee the day after he retired and they printed out a SF-50 for him so he could mail to TSP right away because he had a hardship case. So, yeah, so he was needing the money immediately. And so they printed the SF-50, and he sent that in to TSP, and they were working with him. But, yes, that's how you're exactly right. It flows from our system to their system. They send you out a packet to let you know how much money is in your account, and then you work from there with them. They send you a withdrawal form. That is correct.
Yes, I'll put my hand. One more question.
Uh-huh.
So if I would plan on to retire next September, say,
mm-hmm.
in January, I can go to my TSP and say I want to contribute $24,000, you know, weekly or biweekly. Mm-hmm. That's how you would do it.
You would go into EBIS and electronically do it. It's not done through TSP.
Right. But yeah. I could do the $24,000 in those 9 months.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Or however much you wanted to. So. Right. But make sure you're going to contribute the $18,000 or whatever the limit is for next year to the regular TSP, and then the other $6,000 to the makeup if you're 50.
Oh, so there's two separate sort
there's
of
two
forms.
Separate.
Gotcha, got it.
There's
so you
two
you
separate.
Would do one for the $18,000, you'd figure that out, and then the other one you would put in for the $6,000 catch-up.
That's right.
Ketchup, Heinz. Heinz ketchup.
Yes.
Thank you.
You do the other one for the catch-up. That is correct. And so there's two different funds here. One's regular TSP, which is the $18,000. The other one is the catch-up, which is an additional $6,000. The additional $6,000 is the one you have to do annually. You have to go in every December into EBIS and say, you know what, I want to contribute a little bit extra. Okay, if you're over 50. Okay. Yes, sir.
Talking about the different ways that you could withdraw the money, and so there was single payment, or then sort of a scheduled monthly payment.
Uh-huh.
But can you just say, well, I'm going to just withdraw money when I need it, just like you would in any other account, like in a savings account, or must it be no? You get one single payment, and then you must go with some payment schedule.
That's for TSP to decide, but because they let you do a mixture of different things, this is just my opinion. They should let you do a single payment.
So that's something I need to ask them.
Yes, TSP will answer that most definitely. Good question. Okay. Long-term care insurance. If you have questions about long-term care, please contact their office. We don't do long-term care in our office. So they do take walk-ins, it looks like. They want to walk in? No. So they're open Monday through Friday from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. and Saturdays, too, from 9 to 5. They're closed Sundays and federal holidays, and that's their link if you have long-term care insurance. Flexible spending account. Now, you're not eligible to carry your flexible spending into retirement. So if you're planning on retiring, you might want to make arrangements if you have a flexible spending account so that you don't lose your money. So you need to contact them, and we also have their link and their website. Okay, so now dental and vision, they're already up on the game. They have self plus one. So you can have self only, you can have self and one, and self and family for dental and vision. And that's done through BenFeds. That's who I call whenever I have a issue with my dental and vision. They're the ones who help me out. Okay. If you are within 5 years of retiring, you need to request an estimate. I think I have beat that to death. Please order an estimate so that way you can know where you're sitting at. It's just to be well informed on what's going on with your own retirement so you won't be surprised, you know, like the customer said, I can't retire for 7 more years. So go ahead and request an estimate no more than 5 years prior to being eligible to retire. The rules have changed for our request. The estimate can only be requested once every 3 years now. Your retirement estimate includes verifying your military and your civilian service. So we look into your official personnel record and determine all that. We calculate the amount of civilian and the civilian deposit and redeposit. So we also do that. Impact of unpaid civilian deposit, redeposit, and military on your retirement. So if you don't pay those things, how is it going to affect your retirement? So we let you know that also by ordering an estimate. And we confirm that you have the 5 years of health insurance and life insurance into retirement. Now, if you're on your spouse's federal plan or you're on TRICARE, we can't confirm that you have 5 years. That's something you will just have to know yourself. But just have a game plan for when it's time to retire if you want to make sure that you have FEHB, if you want to consider it, keeping it into retirement. Just have a game plan. This is how the process goes. 5 years prior to your retirement eligibility, contact the Army Benefits Center. That's what we're there for. Call us and ask us any questions that you may have about retirement. 180 days prior to retiring, download the forms. They're on our ABC website. Once you've downloaded the forms, this is what I tell everybody now. Go through the forms and fill them out as much as you can, and then give us a call. One day I was on the phone and I kept getting the same little lady, and she just asked me a question on page 1, and then she'd go to, the next time I got her again, and it was page 2. The third time it was the bottom of page 2, and I said, oh, do you want to just fill out the whole thing and then give me a call back? And oh, that's a good idea. I was like, why didn't I tell her that the first call? So fill out the whole application as much as you can, and just put little tabs on the pages where you have questions or you don't know what to put on there, and then we can help you with that. Or we can help you determine what forms you do need to fill out. And I'm going to have a lot of time here at the end, so I'm actually going to go on our ABC website and show you exactly where the forms are and tell you what forms you need, okay? If that's okay with you, sir, the computer, is that okay? Okay. Okay, so 90 to 120 days before you retire, mail in your form. Please mail in your retirement form. Because, you know, I'm really pushing that, and that sounds comical, but we're on a report card with OPM. And if we don't have your paperwork processed in a timely manner, they don't care that you didn't send it in on time. It just makes the Department of Army look bad, and we don't want that. So if you could put your retirement in as early as you possibly could, we really would appreciate that. And we do understand, like we said, some of our challenges is that VSEPs come out, unexpected things come out in your family members, your parents. You have things that happen that you have to drop it right away. Those are totally understandable. But the ones that I'm just mad at my boss, I'm tired of them. Those are the ones be like, you've been tired of them for a minute. So go ahead and plan out retirement, because it's not a decision that you should just make hastily like that. This is a very important time in your life, and you should be able to enjoy it. So plan it out. Okay? So mail in the originals. Maintain a copy for yourself. So anything that you send us, copy it. Make sure you keep a copy. Provide a good retirement address and a contact number, because when we send that paperwork in to OPM, they're going to look at the retirement address. And so there was a time that OPM was like, we can't find this person. You sent a retirement application in for him. So we mailed packet out. His packet came back to us, the estimate that we did for him. Finally, he calls in and he says, I haven't gotten any paperwork. And I was like, where are you? And he was like, he was on some island somewhere. And we're like, well, we need your forwarding address so that OPM can send you your check and that we can send you your paperwork. So if you plan to move during retirement, we need to know that address. Even if it's not going to be for a few months after you retire, you can also just put an attachment saying, I plan on being in the Bahamas, you know, living there. You know where I'm planning. I'm headed, don't you? So I'm planning on moving to yada yada, you know, when I retire on such and such date. So if you already know your plan, know what date you're going to move there, just add a sheet of paper and put a memo in there to OPM so they'll know where to start mailing your new items to. But your address should be on wherever you're retiring to. That should be on the application. Okay. 30 to 60 days prior to retirement, your retirement is going to be placed with a specialist. So someone at ABC will go get your retirement, or I will place it on their desk, and they will go through it with a fine-tooth comb, make sure everything is correct, make sure that they can download everything from your EOPF, and then they will go through it and create you, put your packet together. They will verify the forms. They're going to process their retirement, and they will call you for final retirement counseling. Now we have even upgraded our system to where you get an email. As soon as a counselor, as soon as you send your packet in, you're going to get an email to let you know that we have your packet. I'm right. Someone said. And then, you got it today? The next day. Very good. And so then, when you're when I put your retirement on someone's desk to work, I put their name in the system. So you will know my retirement is now in somebody's hands. And they'll tell you the time length, because our counselors only have 5 working days to work your retirement, lest they get penalized. So that was probably internal. I probably shouldn't have told you that, huh? Yes.
Contact you requesting an estimate. How long does it take for you to respond to that?
The normal time has been 6 months, 4 to 6 months, but we just went through a big estimate SWOT, and so they offered us overtime and whatnot, and we cleaned up like we had like 6,000 in-house to work, and now we're down to 1,000. So our backlog is already filled, so we've been getting them out. The last estimate I did, because imagine, I work overtime, right? Got 2 kids in college. Last time I worked overtime, we were working August 24th. So we were less than a month out from completing them. But the norm is 3 to 6 months. But right now we're at the 1 month range. So if you called today, hopefully we'd have that to you within 1 month. Okay. Okay. So then we send your packet to DFAST. And I already went over the process with you. So once our specialist completes the packet and calls you for final retirement counseling, they then send your packet to DFAST. 2 to 4 weeks after you retire, you're going to get your final paycheck. You'll also get a lump sum for any annual leave. And annual leave, it really does help you out during that time period when you're that 6 weeks. It seems forever when you're used to getting a paycheck every 2 weeks. So if you, you know, I know people like, well, it's going to be taxed a third. It's still nice to have something to make it to your first retirement check. So if you could, you know, kind of think of your annual leave as my cushion, you know, towards my, while I'm in the window of not getting anything. That, you know, that's kind of a safe way to think of it. I always think that, you know, the annual leave is pretty important because that determines some people's retirement. They were like, well, I can't afford to retire because I'm not going to get anything for 6 to 8 weeks. And I said, did you know that you have a lot of annual leave? And they were like, I said, yeah, it looks like you're going to get like $10,000. They were like, what? So I can retire because they could not afford not to make their house note payment and pay all their bills. So the annual leave is a pretty good thing if you can save it up for retirement, okay? Approximately 8 weeks after you retire, you'll receive your first retirement interim check. And I know I had already went over this, but someone had asked me earlier, so I went over the steps. And you'll also receive a letter from OPM with your CSA number, your Civil Service Annuitant number. So when you get that number, you know that OPM is now your new HR. They are the ones holding everything, all the cards for you at that time. And you can start contacting them. Now, we just don't drop you like a hot potato. We do keep you in our system for 6 months after you retire, just in case you have any questions or anything. Because our old system, when I first started, retirees used to get so angry because we cut them out of the system as soon as they retire. We were like, we can't see you anymore. So now we keep retirees in our system. So that way, if you do have any questions after retirement, you know, because sometimes you have time to sit down and think after you retire. So then the questions start flooding and you'd be like, oh, I didn't ask this, this, and this. And then you go home and the spouse will be like, did you ask this, this, and this? And so the questions start flooding in. So just call the Army Benefit Center. We can help you after retirement if you had any of those kind of questions. Okay.
Are in the middle of a pay period, mm-hmm. I would be looking at a half check. And would they then add the use or lose to that check, even though it may not come for 4 to 6 to 8 weeks?
The 4 to 6 to 8 weeks is your, okay, so there's your last paycheck, and if you, let's say that you do retire in the middle of a pay period, what they normally do is if they have all your documents in time in an orderly fashion, they'll add your lump sum annuity, your use or lose or whatever you have, with that last paycheck. That's what DFAS tries to do. If they don't get it to you in that last paycheck, they give it to you the pay period following. Did I answer? Maybe.
Okay. Tax purposes.
Tax purposes, yeah. It does hit you hard in taxes when they tax the check that you get with your lump sum annual leave. They tax the whole check a third, so, you know, 28%. So it does hit you tax-wise, but then you get your lump sum too, so.
Days.
Huh?
I have mine in 91 days.
You'll have yours in 91
days. I'll submit mine.
Okay.
52 and 91 days.
Well, thank you. Okay. Good questions. You got any more? Okay, so we'll keep going. If you change your mind, we talked about this a little bit earlier too. If you change, once you change or withdraw your retirement, your request to change your retirement date or to withdraw your retirement application must be in writing and you must sign it. And you can fax that in because a lot of times that's the fastest way for us to get it. If you are receiving a VERA or a VSEP, your request must be signed by your CPAC or your HR professional, because they've already allocated this money to you, so, or and it's hard to get that straightened out. So you can't just send us in and say, hey, I changed my mind. I don't want the VSEP, or I don't want to go out on an early retirement. You need to contact your agency, and they will have to sign off on that. Submit the request to Army's Benefit Center as soon as you know that you're not going to retire.
Who is CPAC?
You have a local HR, right, Mr. Hunt?
We're New Cumberland.
Mr. Hunt? Shelley? Shelley Debrimois, okay.
Yeah, we're DLA, so we have an HR up there. Up in New Cumberland, we are. So.
Oh, okay.
I guess we have an HR up there.
Yes. Okay. Okay, so also, I already let you know that if you do change or withdraw your retirement, it could cause problems with your final paycheck if you don't let us know soon enough. So the sooner you know that you can't retire or you don't want to retire, the better. That way it doesn't mess up your check. We've had some people that didn't get their paycheck for like a month. So because it was messed up, because we had already processed their SF-50. And they went to work the next day and just kept on working. And then when the timekeeper went to put in their time card, they were not in the system anymore. So it can cause a big problem. Okay, so here's our contact information. If you want to call us, 877-276-9287. And our specialists are available from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. Central Time. And there's our website, and we're at Fort Riley, Kansas. That's our mailing address. So when you mail your retirement applications in, you can do it to that address. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I have 9 years with the Department of the Navy, mm-hmm. and my last 23 years was with DLA. When I started with DLA, my CSRS contribution started over at zero. Now, I'm sure the government's kept track of how much I put in, but is there any way I can get a copy of what I had in for the 9 years with the Navy?
Yes. So what you're going to do is email retire@opm.gov. And in the subject bar, put retirement contributions. And then make it short and sweet. Give them your name. They probably want your date of birth and some other personal information maybe. But you start out with your name and date of birth and make it like two sentences. Say, you know, just like you told me. And they will send you back saying, okay, this is what we have on you.
All right, thanks.
Not a problem. That's a very common question because when you go from a different agency, they usually don't show you on your new leave and earnings statement how much you've contributed to your old agency. They just start back from zero. Even though they're keeping the money for you, they don't they don't move the amount to your new leave and earnings statement. Very good. Our mailing address? Oh, retire@opm.gov. Okay, so if you call into the Army Benefit Center, most likely you're dialing number 1 for Department of Army employees. And that will put you through a specialist that can assist you on the phones. Okay. Now we're opening up to questions and use the mic. They requested that you use the mic when you asked your questions. Yes, sir. I'm gonna get my phone real quick.
Uh, How often can you change your life insurance, designation? In other words, is that something that you only can change during? Is that something you can only change, like when you retire, or can you? You know, how often, or what are the opportunities you have to change your life insurance coverage?
He said, when can you change your life insurance coverage? When you're talking about 75%, 50%, no reduction?
I mean, of any kind. Let's say right now I decide, I'm now a lot older than what I originally designated when I got married, and so when can you change it?
Okay, good question. So if you wanted to decrease your life insurance, you can decrease at any time. So let's say that you're like me and have Z times 5, because my family can't live without me, I know. But as we get kids through college and we get more stable, I'm going to get rid of that B. And you can decrease at any time. Increasing is like an act of Congress. But guess what? We're going to have an open season. Did you guys hear about that? We're having a life insurance open season. So if you wanted to increase, you can. I believe it's in 2017. It's probably on our ABC website. Can you pull up our website now? Or we can take a break while I pull up all our website stuff. But let me go ahead and finish the questions, and then I'll pull up our website information so you can see when the open season is coming. And I believe it's in 2017, the last email I got. Yes, sir? Did you have a question? Anybody? Yes, ma'am.
On requesting the estimate, can we have you give it to us with no survivor annuity, with this much survivor annuity, with, can you
the
give
different
us
different amounts?
Right.
Okay. So this is what I recommend. If you don't know how much you're going to leave your spouse, do the full. Because the estimate is like a math problem. The way we do the estimate will give you your total, how much you're going to get, and then we'll go to the side and put reductions. And so you'll see the different reductions, and then you can add and subtract the different amounts in. So on the third page, I believe the third or fourth page of the estimate, you'll see where it says survivor annuity. It's usually in the middle of the page, on the fourth page, I believe. And it'll say survivor annuity. It'll say 100%, which means just the 55%. If you're going to leave your spouse a full survivor annuity, it'll tell you how much it's going to cost you and how much they'll get every month. So if you click in full, it'll automatically do the math on the fourth page for you. Either way. Okay, so you have to go back to HR Link, the HR, because did you order through your EBIS?
No. HR.
Right. When you go into EBIS, you click on the HR and you request it, and that's where you go back to look at it. Oh, right, because it's the three-year rule now. They in the first place? Okay. So I can get your name and number and look into it.
Okay.
And I'll also tell my supervisor so she can get that sent to it. So, she's answered some questions, so let's see what she says. The self plus one doesn't start until January 2016, so the slides will be updated to reflect that once it starts. And then she answered the other question about slide offset. Someone asked a question about the offset formula. Yes, and she said the slides are the two examples that we have, and it's just the lesser of the two. So I don't know what formula they actually use, but that's the formula that she's I should have asked her, what is the actual formula? Okay. Okay.
Do you know the formula to figure out the offset?
I have to make sure it says what I said, because sometimes it changes my words. I'm like, no, I don't want to quit my job. Okay, so any other questions? Because if not, I'll let you guys take a break, and then I'll pull up our Army Benefit Center website to show you a few things. Is that okay, Mr. Hunt?